Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Lifetime I saw. That's got 20 years.
Well, when the ACC was finally eliminated, I couldn't watch it.
Was he about 6'6"?
Yeah, he was. Not now.
Is he bent over a little bit?
That tends to happen.
Got that?
That's not fun. Been there, done that. Item number, consent agenda A3, Board of Health.
Could I have your attention, please? Before the meeting starts, we'd like to lead you in prayer, and afterwards, if you would stand for the Pledge of Allegiance, and we pray. Dear God, we thank you for life and for this beautiful day. Give us the strength and the wisdom to do the people's business. And always in the back of our minds and with our votes, we do what is best for Alamance County. Amen.
Amen.
Pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
The Alamance County Board of Commissioners is now in session for the dispatch of its business. First matter on will be our public speakers. We have three. Mr. Hsu.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman, Commissioner.
Good morning, Ed.
We have the $95,000 deal coming up later in the meeting, which brings me back to this collecting this $1,933. Now, we're having three motions going before me. It's going to cost $95,000. How much is it we're paying to collect this $1,900? For this David, whoever he is from down there, you know, not the Jeep fellow. We're $1,933. Are we paying $5,000, $10,000? I hope we ain't paying the $30,000 these other motions are going to cost. But anyway, I would like to know what it's costing to collect $1,933. And I also have here, one of the reasons psychic for the $95,000 is rule changes in the Federal Middle District Court. Now, I have here those rule changes, and I wonder if y'all could ask our county attorney which of these rule changes here is the one that he thinks we can refile these three on and get a different opinion. These are refiling three motions to exclude the expert, DOJ's experts. Well, I have them. Some of them, did we not double space it? That's one of the changes, rule changes. And I actually have all of the policies, but this accents rule changes. When he speaks, could he please tell us which rule change that we are going to win refiling these motions on? And that's basically all I have, sir. Thank you.
Thank you.
Dr. Conyard?
Uh,
I'm the chair for the Alamance Human Relations Council. And as your resolution, we decided that no matter what was in our treasurer, whether it was donated or raised, we were still under the auspices of the Alamance government. So we decided to give you the total amount, which is $3,016.63.
Thank you.
Thank you, Doug.
Tony Cox.
How y'all doing today?
Good, Randy. How you doing?
I'm doing good. You know, people said that I would, as a result of, and I've heard described as David Smith's high impact land use and polluting industries ordinance, the enforcement of it, people said you'll never get an admission of wrongdoing, but I did. Also was instrumental in getting the high impact land use and polluting industries ordinance rescinded. Said you'll never get a public apology. Tim, I believe you apologized. Could be wrong. At the last meeting. But you know, I remember that day too. That hot day. And I was telling a commissioner who I thought would help. Basically what my version was. And instead of saying not under my name, it didn't. They didn't commit fraud under my name. But instead it was, hire a lawyer. And I done tried them all, even Mr. Paisley here. And nobody wanted to help me. I've only asked for three things. Admission of wrongdoing, it's been done. An apology, I take it as an apology. And what can we do to make it right? I've got shovel-ready jobs ready to go like other people do. And back when I was putting those shovel-ready jobs together, I wasn't looking for the government to finance it. I was just looking for government to get out of my way. Doing the best I could. Held to a standard that nobody can be held to. Staff line. And we told you back in 2007 that they was lying. There was even one about a $200,000 rubber tire wheel loader that your lawyer over there said that bought it in August. Done a long-term lease on it, took possession of it in May. Payments $3,000 a month. I don't know how much it was. And when y'all done what y'all done, three people, well, no, there was six people, plus the other liars. Destroyed my credit and a lot of other things because it was taken personal. Because I said I believe in the Constitution, the Bill of Rights, human rights. I believed in the honor and integrity of my government. We're almost there.
Thank you, Tony. Next item of business is any responses by the commissioners? Hearing none, we'll move on to the consent agenda. Is there anything on the consent agenda that needs to be pulled before we consider it? I have a couple. One is the 5A3. That individual, according to the information I received, has not even gone before the Board of Health for their approval. It's a new appointment. Don't have anything biography about the individual. Don't know anything about him. I think that probably needs to come out. And then 5A6, my agenda does not even have a name for that appointment. Brian, who is it you're suggesting we appoint to that board?
The gentleman's name is Bobby Harmon. I have a hard copy of his application.
Was he on before?
Yes, he's currently on. This is a request of reappointment. Yes, sir.
Oh, okay.
I'm not sure why.
The health department
didn't make the.
I thought I remembered.
I think it's just application.
Okay, that's fine. I don't have any problem with that. The health department appointment.
Yeah, I'd like to comment on that. I was told about who this person was, and I asked to have a resume sent to me, and I don't know why in the world it's not in a packet for you to see. I had it.
I'm not sure why.
Oh, me.
Not.
Okay, and then it's on file. I got it. I'm sorry. You know, I don't send them out to people. It's supposed to come from county manager. And I asked for it and got it. And it was submitted about roughly, almost 4 weeks ago. Is that not correct?
Yes, sir.
Okay. And then you called me on, Friday?
Yes, sir.
Okay. And told me that, insinuated that it might be pulled off the agenda due to what you're referring to. And then you said you talked to the health director.
Or talked to the chairman of the board.
Chairman of their board. Mm-hmm. And he said what?
He said that it had not been reviewed by the board. However, he had had a conversation with the applicant as well, and he had no problem for the application moving forward.
So I don't know how it got on our agenda to start with, as far as, you know, being put out there to have the appointment voted on and consent. You couldn't tell me that either.
Right.
I think you said you put it on there because you thought I was rushing.
I put it on there because not that you were rushing it.
Well, I wanted it. I was going to support it.
Yes, sir.
Okay, yeah. You know, I think to delay it, in my opinion, is a little bureaucratic, considering who we've talked to on this. And I hope that his occupation is not a... Do you even know what he does?
No, I have no earthly idea. Do you, John?
I do not. I think what we have before us right this minute is whether to remove it from the consent agenda or not the full discussion of the issue.
Yeah.
Well, I'll support taking it off the agenda. He's a chiropractor, and I think he's very qualified. And I think for it to not have had that resume sent to us, I hope it's not a purposeful attempt to keep somebody that profession off the health.
No, sir. This is a general appointment for the board. So it's not a doctor's appointment or anything else. This is a general appointment to the board. So there, you know, not any specific requirements for this position.
Well, all of them should have had what I got. How many days ago? 4 or 5 days ago.
Yes, sir.
And that way, you'd have what you needed.
Yeah.
Well, I got what I needed.
I think it's what John said. We're not considering his qualifications. I'd just like to know what they are. And I say put it off until the next meeting.
I'll support that. But I asked the same question 5 days ago.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. And why y'all don't have it now
apologize. I'm not sure why you don't, but we'll check into that.
Well, I think it's a bad oversight.
Well, the health department needs to look at it anyway before we consider.
Right. They sure do. Right.
Whether we had the information or not, it's almost immaterial.
Is the board in agreement that we...
I disagree.
Is the board in agreement we take it off the consent agenda?
I support.
Yes.
I support taking it off.
All right. We have a motion to approve the agenda less 5A3.
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Amen.
That's the health board call.
Excuse me, but didn't really realize I had it in my pocket. Left kind of early this morning and it was raining. All in favor of the motion, please signify by saying aye.
Uh-huh. Aye.
Next matter is a request to set a public hearing. Who is it, Jason? Is it? Was that the?
Here, Jason's coming down.
Just this on the back.
See, that's in the container, isn't it?
It's on the back.
Yeah, here we go. Okay. Economic development, public hearing. Do, who's going, Mac, are you going to present that to?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Come up now?
Go ahead and ask us what you want us to do.
Well, thank you for the opportunity to be here. I'm Mac Williams. I'm president of the Alamance County Chamber of Commerce. I'm here to introduce to you this morning a project that's considering a new manufacturing facility for Alamance County. Cambro Manufacturing is here today for their incentives consideration from the county. We have a PowerPoint presentation about the company and the project for you this morning, and hopefully it's loaded up and ready to go, or can be very shortly. I have with me this morning to talk about the company, to talk about the project, to answer your questions, the questions the public may have. The owner of the company, it's a privately held company, and the company owner is here this morning, Argyle Campbell. And so I'm going to ask Argyle to come up to the podium, and we'll go through the slideshow and explain who the company is and his company and what this project is about, and we'll go from there. So with that, Argyle?
With the board's approval, we will listen to the presentation and then go into a public hearing.
So moved.
Ladies and gentlemen, Argyle Campbell.
Here's my little clicker link.
I'll second the motion.
Right here?
All in favor of?
Good morning, I'm Argyle Campbell. I'm the owner of Cambro Manufacturing Company. I thought it would be a good time to tell everybody a little bit about my company, and because we are requesting some incentives. So I prepared a little slideshow so I can make it work. That doesn't seem to be working. What? Oh, that's going to work better now, okay. Okay, the company was founded in 1951 by my father and uncle. It was originally called the Campbell Brothers, so they were smart and they shortened it to Cambro. So our first product was a tray used in for hospital patient service called the Cam Tray. Our headquarters are in Huntington Beach, California, and we do manufacture all over the world. We have two manufacturing facilities in Huntington Beach. We have a manufacturing facility just outside of Stuttgart, Germany. We have just outside of Istanbul on the Asian side in Gebze, and a manufacturing facility in Huizhou in southern China. So not only do we manufacture in all those locations, we also distribute from those locations as well. We have about 800 employees in the United States, and worldwide it's about 1,200. So, and our revenues are just slightly in excess of $300 million. I'm telling you all this secret stuff. Don't tell my competitors, please. Our business is 100%. We design, manufacture, and market products for the food service, the commercial food service industry, including hotels, healthcare, caterers, restaurant chains, and all other food services businesses. Like, we drove by Krispy Kreme this morning, and I happened to mention to Mac, hey, they're a Cambro customer. So, anyway, you find Cambro products in any place where you would eat away from the home if you look hard enough. Most of that is behind the in the back of the house. So we offer about 14,000 items. Primarily trays, food storage containers, commercial shelving. We have a big line of catering products that we make. We have a whole warewashing system, and we are actually in the last 5 or 6 years we've gone after the healthcare, actually the meal delivery to patients, the tabletop item or the tray top items. Here's a little selection of the products that we offer. trays, containers, a portable bar, shelving, ware washing racks, plate covers, a little kiosk thing, food bar. The one on the bottom there is the healthcare systems, our insulated beverage carrier, and a plate cart. Okay, what we're looking at here is we do find ourselves. It's a good problem. We actually do need additional capacity. Cambro sells about 70% of our products we sell in North America and about 30% overseas. We actually, from a manufacturing situation, we manufacture about 90% of our products that we make in North America and 10% overseas, so it's a little skewed. We're looking at a capital investment of about $34 million, $10 million in the, including the land and the building, and then about $23, $24 million to equip it. We're looking at within the next probably two years, maybe a little longer than that, about 100 jobs with the average salary of $44,000. And so the annual payroll, you can see, would be $4.4 million plus benefits. We would start out by building a facility of around 220,000 square feet, and the site size is 28 acres. Wow. And by the way, I didn't say this, but if after I've done, if you have any questions, just feel free to ask them. Be happy to answer. Okay, what we do is we are molders, and what we're looking at is 10 injection molding machines, one thermoforming machine, and what that does, if you, anybody have coffee here, you see that disposable lid on the top of your coffee that you sip through? Well, we buy that from an outsourced manufacturing company, and we want to bring that in-house. There you go, just like that. But in the healthcare business, everything that comes on the tray top in a hospital has a disposable lid on it. That's the market that we're going after. You can't believe in a 300-bed hospital over the course of the year how many of those disposable lids are actually used. You probably never thought of it, but you figure somebody's got to make those. So that's a thermoforming machine. This one spot that is sort of in the running has the opportunity to have a rail spur, which would, for raw material delivery, which is desirable. We build silos to hold our raw material, and we're considering pulling it in manufacturing and distribution under one roof. We're currently using a 3PL logistics company out of Atlanta to service the eastern third of the United States. So that's what we want to pull together in this facility. Okay, the where we're looking at is the North Carolina Industrial Center. It's right off Highway 70, and we have to do a little rezoning of that property. It's an old dairy farm, right, Nick?
Correct.
Yeah.
And your site, Argyle, is the very top one
Very top one, the rectangular one.
It's the very top one up there in that picture.
Right. You want anything else on that picture?
Everything else up here is just kind of conceptual about, if once we get rail to your spot, conceivably we can get rail to those other spots as well.
Correct.
Okay. Just to give everybody a frame of reference, on the right-hand side is the proposed 119 bypass, and along the very top of the picture is US 70 and the North Carolina Railroad corridor. Yeah. Just to give yourself, that's just on the west side of Nevin.
Okay. Sorry, it's a little small, but in the lower part, the rectangle in the lower part would be the initial construction. And then the additional build out to about 500,000 square feet. So that's the additional, sort of, if you go to the right top, that's the additional next phase. With the lobby and everything, it would be down on the bottom right, and that's the parking, and then the all the truck doors are on the right-hand side of the building, you can see there. Okay, so we've been working on this project for a while. We're looking at different sites. We're actually continue to try to figure out if we might still be able to do it in California and a couple of different sites here in North Carolina. We've looked at different states in the southeast. And the town of Mebane and Alamance County are one of the two finalists. So we got announced that we have a public hearing on the incentives, and I thought it'd be a good idea to come tell you a little bit about Cambro. So I'm here. Okay, we're gonna make the decision. We can make the decision pretty fast on what to do. I'm the owner of Cambro. I'm also the chairman, and I'm the board of directors, so it doesn't take me too long to look in the mirror and figure out what's going to happen. So we can start pretty quick. We'd like to start our construction in June. We need to recruit and hire people and train people. We want to make sure that the training is done perfectly, so on the day we start up, our customers see sort of a seamless service out of Cambro. We just did this whole process in Germany, and it didn't work out quite as seamless as we hoped, so we learned some valuable but tough lessons in that little project. We think we can have this construction completed by the end of the year and start right in January of 2015. That's it. Okay. So I would be happy to take any questions. Any questions you have about the project or Cambro, feel free to ask. Between Mac and I think we can answer whatever you might have. So,
thank you, Mr. Campbell. If you would hold off on your questions until we go into the public hearing,
and okay, sure.
We have a question for you.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Do we have a motion to go into public hearing?
So moved.
Second.
I'll second it.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
All right, folks, we'll start on my right-hand side, this whole group, back row. Anybody want to speak? The second from back row. The second row from the front here. And the front row, anybody on this side? All right, let's go over to the...
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
May I speak?
Sure.
My familiarity with so-called incentives goes back a long ways, longer than any of yours does. Back when Puerto Rico had no voting representative in Washington, but they didn't need voting representative, they had high-priced lawyers. Plants were closing in Alamance County with all kinds of excuses while they were opening plants in Puerto Rico, and the whole reason was not because of cheap or efficient labor or cheap land. It was because of tax incentives, giving away other people's tax money to industries coming to Puerto Rico. Now, 40 years later, 50 years later, I defy anybody to show to me, to prove to me, that Puerto Rico is economically or sociologically better off because of these incentives. I will tell you what a good incentive is. A good incentive is to have a willing, prepared workforce. And a good incentive is to keep the faith with the existing taxpayers. We have a lot of very, very good and loyal taxpayers here that are not very pleased that their government is going to be taking money from them to give to possibly would be taxpayers someday. I think that keeping the faith with the taxpayers, with the people, is a good incentive. And I think if we held firm to the to honoring the people who make this county, who make this state, and not taking the term I have for it is kind of brutal. I call it extortion and bribery. I don't know. Business is built by small business. That is truth. That's not imagination. Small business never gets an incentive. They start, they pay taxes on the property when they're building on it. Most cases they have to pay to have their water lines hooked up, and their electric lines hooked up, and their gas lines hooked up. And if they're, unless they get really lucky, they got to pay to train the people. I encourage y'all to think about the long-term impact of so-called incentives to hand-picked people from wherever. Stand by your taxpayers, your people. Alamance County has some fantastic working people. I noticed that they said that the average salary was $44,200. I think that's probably the mean. I wonder what the median is. The median is probably $22,000. Now, the median, as you know, I hope you know, is the salary at which the person in there, where there's as many people making more than that woman or man what makes, as there is making less. Now, that number, when you're looking at something, eliminates the skewing of having a few very high paid people. It skews the mean. But it doesn't, I mean, in the final analysis, it doesn't matter. You give this money to this company, and you're breaking the faith with a lot of citizens and taxpayers. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Anybody else on this side of the room want to speak? Yes, ma'am.
Linda Amplinow, Burlington, North Carolina. Good morning, council members.
Good morning.
I'm going to speak in opposite to the gentleman who just spoke. Incentive agreements are becoming the norm. In order to attract businesses and jobs, the new business form is in incentives. Incentives do not take tax money from taxpayers. Rather, they negate taxes from the companies paying it for a certain amount of time. In the end run, you would gain more taxes by having the facilities here in the county. You gain more jobs, you gain more taxes from those jobs. In all, it is a very win-win situation in an economy that has changed the face of attracting businesses. I urge you to consider seriously Cambro Manufacturing as a new and a welcome addition to Alamance County, its tax structure, and its wage structure. Thank you for your consideration.
What was your occupation?
Medical technologist, retired many years.
The reason I asked, I thought you might be involved in a personnel agency. And that's
No, sir.
I just wanted to know. Thank you.
Can you give me your name again?
Linda Amplinow.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you. Someone else? Thank you. Yes.
Morning. Thank you for the opportunity to speak. I had the pleasure to go out to Huntington Beach, California, visit with Cambro, see their plants in California. Just wanted to give you some perspective that they are a real manufacturer, great jobs, world-class products, distributing throughout the globe. They're the right kind of company that we want here, the right kind of hard-working manufacturing, good products, good company. We need them here. I urge you to approve it. Thank you.
Give us your name, please.
Brian Hall.
And you're with the firm that owns the property of the development?
With Samet Corp.
That's
yes,
what
sir.
I thought. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? Yes, sir.
There's the personnel agency.
Mr. Sutton, I do own a personnel agency.
Yeah, I knew that.
I'm Randy Perkins, the owner of Prime Personnel Resources. We have 100 people a week coming through our doors every week looking for jobs. We don't have all the jobs we need. This is an outstanding company. Injection molding is great manufacturing. I encourage you to consider these incentives. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Anyone else on this side? All right, over here to my left. Anybody on this side of the room want to speak? Tony?
Go ahead.
Mr. Chairman, Commissioner, the question I would ask and would like answered before we vote, is this company going to be in competition with any of the plastic companies? I don't know the process, but any of the plastic companies we have locally do injection molding at now or even in the future? Has anybody checked to see their plans? Or are we having somebody come in and compete with people that didn't get the incentives and have been here? And that's basically one of the questions I'd like to know. Thank you.
Thank you, Eddie. Tony?
Tony Cox. My first question would be, is this a done deal? Are y'all coming here?
Not a done deal.
Not a done deal.
Nope.
If you don't get the money, will you come?
Have to consider other locations.
We got good taxes here. Property taxes is real low.
Say it again.
Property taxes are real low. Just by moving out of California and bringing your executive offices here, I hear that it's like 30%. Is that true?
Well, we're not planning to move our executive offices.
Yeah, but we want you to come. Come on. We need schools here. We need a lot of things, don't we? We need some good help here, too. But we want you here. We need jobs. No doubt about it. We need them jobs.
But we like to come, that's for sure.
Well, what can I do to get you to come? I tell you what, let's ask this. If you get the incentive, will you promise that money to build a school?
Let's not get totally out of line here.
Well, I'm not out of line.
Well, then tell us what you want to tell us, Tony.
I'm doing it.
This board.
Well, he said ask questions.
Well, I think you've asked enough questions. Anything else you want to say about it?
Yeah, there's a lot I want to say. Why do you have a problem with me? It started with you in 2007.
We're not getting into that, Tony. Now, you're out of order. You want to say something?
You always accuse him.
Then say it.
I was saying it.
Sit down.
I was saying it. I don't understand what the deal is with you and me. I ain't never done nothing to you. Never. Never.
Sheriff.
Yes. Would
you please remove this gentleman? Yes.
You don't want to come here.
Anyone else on this? Yes, sir.
Good morning, I'm Bob Bird and I live in Burlington. I grew up in an injection molding plastics company family. My dad owned an injection molding plastics company. And as you probably know, I spent 35 and a half years in the healthcare business. So it kind of too mean something to me with this company. And I would recommend moving forward with the incentives, just recognizing the economic incentive realities of today in our current situation, as the one woman explained. I would agree with that. I think it would be a good business for us to have. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else on this side? Yeah, Mr. Moser.
Good morning, commissioners. Thank you for your service to the county. I want to congratulate Mr. Campbell on your success with your company. I was impressed hearing of your products and your success, and truly congratulate you. I think it's outstanding. However, I have been an opponent through the years as a taxpayer. I've been an opponent against incentives. I'll get that right out. But I had a couple of questions that your vice president, Mr. Steve Williams, I'm not sure if he's here.
Steve Thompson,
had made the comment, I thought, to the Daily Times News that the industrial center was selected because of the proximity to our highway system. And so that's one question you might discuss later. And when you mentioned highway system, I just wanted to, and I don't, do we have a time limit, Chairman?
It's not a public hearing.
Okay, I just wanted to think, it got me to thinking about our highway system in Alamance County. We are the corridor, I believe Matt called us the corridor, and I'm thinking if you travel 85 40 south, you'll go through Greensboro, and then if you travel 40, you're going to go through Winston, you're going to get to Asheville, North Carolina, the beautiful mountains, within 3 hours from Burlington. If you travel across the mountains in like an hour, you're going to be in Knoxville, Tennessee to distribute your products. If you come back to Greensboro, instead of traveling 40, if you travel Interstate 85, you're going to go to Charlotte. You can go on down, you can take 77 south to Columbia, South Carolina, capital of Columbia. You can stay on 85 and you'll have your product in Atlanta, Georgia, and probably, 4 and a half hours from Burlington. If you go through Atlanta on Interstate 20 west, within 2 hours' time, you're going to be in Birmingham, Alabama with your product. It's just a great location here, and I think that's what your folks have indicated. Instead of traveling 20 west out of Atlanta, if you take 85 south from Atlanta, you're going to be in, I think it's the capital of Alabama, you're going to be in Birmingham, you're going to be in Montgomery, Alabama. So that's a great route. If you come back and travel north and east on Interstate 40 and 85, you're going to be in Durham, North Carolina, and just a short distance from Evan. We got Duke University, NC State, Chapel, North Carolina, Tar Heels. I'm a Duke fan. Don't hold that against me, some of you folks. But my point is, if you travel 40 east, another 2.5 hours, you at Port City of Wilmington and our beautiful North Carolina coastline. You could take 85 north and you're in Richmond, Virginia, Petersburg, and Washington, D.C. So I want our commissioners to please keep this in mind when we want to keep giving out incentives, saying this is the only way we're going to get corporations or distributors in Burlington and in Mebane in Alamance County. Let's keep in mind our proximity. And I guess, Mr. Campbell, that's one question I would like to ask. I have read through the years that incentives, if you're weighing the different options, is the reasons why a company's located. Incentives are low on the totem pole as to why they would make their decision. So please just answer some of those questions if you would. I commend you again for being a $300 million company. And I guess I just have to wonder, $600,000, I'm sure you're going to get the incentive, no doubt, but if $600,000, what would make the difference in your company being successful? The location of Alamance County or the $600,000? I'd like to have that question answered. And only one other thing. This past Saturday, Graham Appearance Committee asked for volunteers to clean up trash on the streets. And I'm proud to say that I spent time along with a lot of other people, and a lot of youngsters were helping, cleaning up trash, cups, restaurant, trash, so forth. And so my question is, does your company, or what could you do to make products, and I hope you're doing that, that will be like biodegradable products? That's a question I have. Folks, we need to try to take steps and actions to help better clean up our county from trash. So, again, thank you, folks, for your time, and appreciate the opportunity to speak.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Anyone else on this side of the room? Do I have a motion to close?
Can I say something?
Yes, sir. Okay. Do I have a motion to close the public hearing?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Public hearing is now closed.
I want to say that I've been to 2 ribbon cuttings this week. And it's wonderful. So thank you. I don't think it was your ribbon cutting. I was at Indolore this week. And I've also been over, we had another ribbon cutting over on the other side of town too. So, because I go to all the ribbon cuttings and I'm happy to go. They feed me. But I just want you to know that I do go to the ribbon cuttings, and I don't know of any that I've missed. So if you need to know anything about them, just ask me and I can certainly. And I look forward to your ribbon cutting.
All right, commissioners, comments on the public hearing and the proposed incentive?
Yes. Mr. Campbell, first of all, I want to say I like your last name. I went to Campbell College, which is now Campbell University, and I welcome you to Alamance County. I think we've got the greatest county out of 3,000 and some odd counties in the United States, and I think you'll love it here. And I do think you'll enjoy our property tax rate. That's one of the lowest probably in the United States as far as what you get for your dollar and so forth and so on. And I just want to say up front, I'm not going to support the incentive, not because of you, your business, or anything. It's just my principle on voting on cash incentives. I have been in favor of infrastructure placement for probably 10 years. I have voted for cash in the past, and it just got to the point where I just couldn't do it anymore. And so it's nothing personal at all. And I'm sure you've got a great company. I do want to ask you about 4 questions here. I'll just put them all together. Is the $44,000 wage, is that inclusive of benefits, or is that base salary?
I think that's base plus incentives.
What? Incentives.
Benefits?
Yes.
What kind of benefits? Or
well, you confused me on the base plus incentives. What do you mean by incentives? For the employee?
Employee incentives, health care,
okay, benefits,
all that kind of stuff.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay, that's benefits. I read an article in the Orange County Register. I think it was done about, and that's in California. That's where you're located. Is that correct?
Yeah.
Where there was a downturn in the business, not your business, but I think overall the product, and that you had to address some financial issues with your company. And that the first thing you went after as far as cutting cost effective was temporary workers. And what use of temporary workers will this facility have here?
Okay, well, all right. I'm
First off, I'm not a big proponent of temporary workers. We do use them a little bit to flex our workforce out in California. I don't know that would probably be the case here. I'm more of a proponent of the permanent workforce. So the problem with the temporary workforce is you're constantly training, right? Never seems to go away. You're going to constantly be training a permanent workforce, but at least you're building up some equity in your training activity. So I'm more of a proponent of permanent than temporary, although I have to say with the ability to flex a little bit, the temporary, that's where it comes in.
Can you say a rough estimate of what percentage of your 100 that we're talking here will be temporary versus full-time?
I can't imagine it could be more than 10%, really, honestly.
All right. Next question is environmental impact. Is there any to speak of as far as disposal or water, so forth and so on?
No. The kind of molding we're going to do, injection molding and thermoforming, has really no impact whatsoever.
All right. Okay. That's my last direct question. I would say to the people that have insinuated, it's a induction in the debate, in my opinion. The insinuation is the businesses won't come without incentives. And I disagree with that. We're scared to take that risk. And frankly, I believe that we've got enough to sell without giving out cash. Now, you're shaking your head. No, you don't agree with me. But the bottom line is, I think to assume that we would lose every possible good company because we don't give out cash, that we would lose them. I just disagree with that. But anyway, welcome to Alamance County.
Thank you very
and
much.
I think you will be coming here.
Okay. Thank
good
you.
Luck.
Mr. Campbell, you or Mike have anything else you want to add to the commissioners here? Some of the questions that were asked by the public.
Well, I can only say that I'm a taxpayer, believe me. And I have some of my family, the first time they get a tax bill, they go, oh my God, I got to pay tax. I said, don't look at me. Not getting any sympathy from your uncle or your grandfather or your father. I said, I'm a taxpayer too, so I'm always a little, I worry about how taxes are spent. I think this is a great way. I come from California, and I've never, they could care less whether or not you come, go, stay sideways, as long as you pay your taxes. So this is one of the reasons we're considering this area, and I hope you'll vote in our favor. Thanks.
Let me ask you, excuse me, this may be an unfair question, but it is, just simply don't answer it.
No, that's okay.
What other North Carolina site are you considering?
Well, we've got a couple of sites over in Greensboro that we're looking at.
All right. And you know their tax rate?
Yep.
All right. 50%
higher.
How dependent are the incentives here coming to Alamance County?
They're a factor. We're still going to talk to. We have some conversations with the state as well as with the city, and that we're talking to the city this evening. So it's just part of the puzzle, really.
Yeah. Anything else?
I'm one of those people who don't believe in incentives, but Alamance County needs jobs, and everywhere in the southeast has got beautiful weather, and they've got the same thing to offer that we have. And if we don't give incentives to companies like Combro, we're going to be out of luck. They're going to move somewhere else. Just because we're in a great location doesn't help those companies locate here. I'm going to support this thing.
Anything else, Mr. Campbell?
Thank you very much for allowing us to present our case, and hopefully we'll be successful.
May I ask just a comical, rhetorical question? Why don't you make surfboards?
Okay, I'll tell you a little story. I participate in competitive sailboat racing at sort of small boat level, and I used to ask my dad, who started the company, why don't we get into the recreational side of plastic manufacturing? He says, you want to be able to afford to go sailing? Don't. That's the reason.
Mr. Chairman, also, yes. Mr. Moser asked some really, really good questions. Mr. Moser, would you like to have a one-on-one with Mr. Campbell Just well, ask
I know that's the wrong question. I was just concerned about the trash burning out. Not saying your product was burning out. That was a concern. Yeah. Or are you looking at making
The public hearing is over, please. It's the commissioner's time to talk and listen. Okay?
And also, having a business in downtown Graham, I appreciate what you did Saturday. But two, Mr. Campbell, let me ask that you answer that question about the biodegradable issues and so forth of your product.
The products that we make, here's how it works. They are that the material is actually recyclable. Normally, what happens in a plastic manufacturing scenario is that it's recyclable to a lesser use. All the material we use has to be FDA approved for food contact, because it's food contact. So, but it can be, in theory, it can be recycled. It's a little clumsy to do it, because you have to collect it, you have to grind it, you got to extrude it. So in theory, it can happen. The infrastructure really isn't there to really do it very successfully at this point in this country. One of the big issues is that all the products that we make go into cartons. All the cartons go to the distributors. The distributors then send it out to our customers. Then the customers are faced with just like every other business. So what am I going to do with all this cardboard? That's probably more of a problem than the plastic, because the plastic that we produce, the products are in service for, I don't know, 5 or 6 or 7 or 8 or 9 years or maybe 10 years. So, you know, recycling that is less of a problem than just the dunnage of the packaging. And when you run a factory, the amount of packaging that you receive is unbelievable. What you do with them, compact it, don't compact it, that's the issue, really.
I guess we in Alamance County are pretty aggressive about cardboard, corrugated cardboard particularly.
Yeah.
So I think that issue we have a handle on.
Yeah.
And of course we'll work with you very carefully and closely regarding that issue. And you're right, those carts and various things, hopefully they are going to last a lot of years.
Right.
Right now I'm not aware of anything that Alamance County, and I'd ask the rest of the board, about recycling of plastics and so forth.
No.
I'm pretty aggressive at my office and my home about recycling, but I'm not aware of anything. I know we recycle bottles and yep. things of that sort,
yep.
but commissioners or maybe Mr. Honeycutt, is there anything out there that we could do to recycle some of those products that are being manufactured? And I have one other question as well.
I guess it depends on the type of plastics that there is, and basically what we do in the county is household recyclables. I don't think, and Greg would be the person to ask, is industrial plastic recycling, and I don't think we do any of that, or we know of a market or how to collect that. So that may be something, if they do come, we could have that discussion with Greg about.
Well, nobody that I'm aware of does it. I'm just saying that in theory it's possible, but just setting up the infrastructure to do it, nobody's been able to accomplish that. So
thank you.
One more. Is E-Verify an issue in California as far as being hard to implement versus what you'll have to do in North Carolina by state law as far as having to use the E-Verify program?
We use it.
Okay. Yeah. No problem out there with the verifications?
No. I'm not the... thank goodness I'm not the director of HR. So, no.
Okay. And we do have that in our agreement.
Yeah. Kind of state law.
Yeah.
Chairman, I at some point want us to discuss how long it's going to take us to recover the incentives and so forth through taxes and things of that sort. I'm not sure this is a time to ask that question.
Yeah. Ask the manager.
What we're looking at is based upon the agreement is 2% upon investment, and that will put us in the black. It will be paid over time. If we do the full $339 million and we pay that over a five-year period, it's about $168,000 annually. The taxes on that is approximately $200,000. So we would be in the black during this time frame. And then once the 687, I'm sorry, is it 687 is paid over that 5 years, then we will get the full amount annually.
But it's a misnomer to use the word recover or recoup.
I understand.
Because you would have gotten the full, the net would have been, you know, obviously what they would pay if they came without this.
Right.
And that's the risk we all have to take.
Except that that business and that tax base wouldn't be here without Cambrough.
That's exactly right.
Well, if they came without the incentive, if they came without the incentive, they would be here. And they would be paying their full, they'd be paying what they're going to pay anyway. It's just there wouldn't be any cash going back to them. So we don't recoup, we don't recover. And you're making an assumption that they wouldn't come here without the incentive, and I don't buy that angle.
I assume that you won't be the sole one to make the decision as to Alamance County or Guilford or whatever. I assume you have a committee or a board or something of that sort that will make the final decision.
Well, that's funny about Canberra. We it's not a democracy.
You're the owner of the business. I assume you make the decision.
What's that?
Right? I say you're the owner of the business. I assume you make that decision.
That is very true.
Where are you looking at locating here? Do you have a plan for where you're going to locate it at?
Yes, off 70.
In Mabin. Okay.
Yeah, in Mabin.
Yeah, because I live close to that. So.
Yeah. This is the largest single investment that I've ever made with the company or personally. So, it's a big deal for me. So,
I'll be at your ribbon cut.
I'll look for you.
She's good at those.
Thank you.
And
thank
I look forward to being there as well.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Anything else from the commissioners on this matter?
Call a question.
Is there a motion?
So moved.
We accept these the proposal.
So moved.
There's a second.
Second.
Any further discussion? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed?
No.
That's 4-1?
4-1.
4-1. Motion passes.
On my tombstone, after I leave or retire from the commission, they're going to put 4-1 on my tombstone.
Well, thank you. Mr. Campbell, welcome to Alamance County.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. All right, for the next business, proclamation, alcohol awareness, Brittany Easer. Brittany, here she is.
She's right there.
Hello, my name is Brittany Ezer.
I'm sorry.
It's fine, everybody messes it up. I'm a senior at Rivermill, and next year I will be going to Wake Forest.
Yay.
Today I would like to present the alcohol awareness and talk it up, lock it up proclamation. Yeah. Whereas April is Alcohol Awareness and Talk It Up, Lock It Up Month in Alamance County, and whereas alcohol is defined by the World Health Organization as a Group 1 carcinogen and is the third leading preventable cause of cancer, and whereas alcohol kills more kids than all illegal drugs combined, and underage drinking costs the citizens of North Carolina over $1.2 billion in medical care, work loss, and pain and suffering associated with the multiple problems resulting from the use of alcohol by youth. And whereas youth who begin drinking before age 15 are 4 times more likely to develop alcohol dependence and are 2.5 times more likely to become abusers of alcohol than those who begin drinking at age 21. And whereas in 2013, 18.9% of ninth grade students and 40.2% of high school students in Alamance County reported using alcohol in the past 30 days. And whereas kids get alcohol from their home or someone else's home more than from any other source. And parents and other adults need to send and model a consistent, clear message that underage drinking is not acceptable behavior or a rite of passage. And whereas if adults monitor and secure alcohol in their home, they would actively reduce the problem of underage drinking in the community. And partnering with local law enforcement, parents, civic groups, local schools, businesses, elected officials, and other citizens to talk up the problem and raising community support for the Lock It Up portion of the Talk It Up, Lock It Up campaigns are effective ways to reduce youth access to alcohol in the home. Now, therefore, the Alamance County Board of Commissioners does proclaim April 2014 as Alcohol Awareness and Talk It Up, Lock It Up Month in Alamance County, North Carolina. The Alamance County Board of Commissioners, on behalf of the Alamance County Youth Advisory Council and Alamance Citizens for a Drug-Free Community, request that the parents and adult citizens consider their decisions based on the question, is it good for the children? And support the advocacy and awareness efforts in Alamance County.
Any comments?
I'd like one graduate of Elon undergrad and Wake Forest Law School, so congratulations. Those are the two best universities in the entire country, so congratulations.
Thank you.
And I'm, of course, not biased, but we really appreciate this. I have four children. I now have five and a half. The half is, will be born in May and so forth. This is a major issue, and I really appreciate what you're doing.
I want to tell you, I do driver's ed. Best thing that's ever happened to me. I've done it 12 years. Kids I drive at Northwest Guilford High School in Greensboro, they're my second family. Matter of fact, they're my only family now, basically, except for my sons. I spend a great deal of time talking about alcohol. It is the number one drug in the United States. And it's sad to hear stories that at parents' homes, they're playing beer pong. You know what beer pong is?
I do.
And it's no offense. I mean, I'm glad you know. But it's sad that you do, in a way. Beer pong is, I can't really describe it. I know ninth graders are playing it. 10th graders are playing it. But can you describe what beer pong is here? Can you tell the board?
I think the question isn't what beer pong is. It's more about the problems that we see alcohol as such a good and easy thing to do. And it's so easy to access it, and it's thought of as fun. So beer pong is just another game.
How's that game played?
I haven't played it. I know friends that play it. From what I hear, you line up a bunch of cups and you throw balls, ping pong balls, into the cups. And if you make it, the other opponent has to drink. I think that's how it works.
I'm not sure. Just saying, that's going on in homes of parents. And they had it another school that I'm aware of, a student brought vodka into a water bottle and literally passed out in the cafeteria drunk from alcohol from his parents' home. And they had a raid here in Alamance County where, this is unbelievable, where the parents went out of town and they had a keg party. And these were 9th, 10th, 11th graders. And the police showed up. And when the police showed up, children scattered like rabbits, and one girl ran through the woods, ran into a tree, and broke her nose. I mean, I don't think people have the slightest idea how bad it is in our community with teen drinking, and Lord knows, it's, and I appreciate your involvement.
Thank you. We have pens. We did ask at the end that you consider, is it good for the children when you make your decisions? So when you decide,
thank you.
Please.
Thank you.
Thank you, Brittany.
Thank him.
Thank you, ma'am. Good luck.
Oh, thank you.
Appreciate that. Do we have a motion to accept the proclamation?
So moved.
Second.
Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
North Carolina Forest Service. Walter.
Good morning.
Good morning, sir.
My name is Keith Walters, and I work with the North Carolina Forest Service, and I'm your Alamance County Ranger. Our Assistant County Ranger, Philip Ramsey, he's been here 3 years, and we have half of an equipment operator in Alamance County. He lives here, but he goes to Hillsboro where the tractor is, but we pay half his salary. If you look on page one, you'll see our budget request of $203,085, and the county pays 40% of that. The state pays the remaining 60. For that money, you get the two county personnel, which is funded at the 40%. But you also get a service forester, water quality forester, urban forester, pest control forester, that are fully funded by the state that we can call anytime we need help. We do forest protection, insects and disease, fire, we're on call 24, at least one of us are on call 24/7. The wildfire is our number one concern, but we also do all risk incidents, hurricanes, floods, ice storms. The Alamance County Fire Marshal requested chainsaw crews this year. We had five crews here that afternoon of the request. They started work the next morning. Orange County called in 10 crews, same thing. They were here that night or the next morning. They patrolled, checked or cleared 247 miles of roads while they were here, and they left Sunday a little bit before lunch. But we can get a large number of people here quick whenever there's an impact to Alamance County. The dozer is stationed in Hillsboro. We're shared with Orange County. He's also our district operator. So whenever another county in our district needs help, he's the first dozer to go help those people. Most of the time when we plow a fire, he's usually busy because we're one of the last ones to get caught up because we have such good rural fire departments. We usually use Chatham County or Caswell County's tractor when we plow fires most of the time. But he's still living in Alamance County and he's our operator. On forest management, we did 45 forest management plans the previous fiscal year. We're at 26 this year. Total acreage, a little bit over 3,000 acres that we have under forest management for this year, or new acreages. We assist landowners with reforestation, any other tracts that are cost shared. The state and the feds have a cost share program which help get tracts that are cut replanted. Last year we planted 373,000 trees in Alamance County that we were involved with. We're looking, that was 686
acres. How many trees did you say you planted?
373,000 trees. It was 686 acres. And we're looking, on the books this year we've got 663, but we're just completing our tree planting this year and we haven't totaled all the acreages and checked everything yet. So we're not, what we pad the acres for what we put on the books for cost share, just to make sure everything's covered, and then when we measure it, it drops it just a little bit. So we're gonna be about the same as last year. Since the tobacco buyout, we've had a lot of farmland and stuff converted back to trees. With the ag industry aging out, a lot of people aren't, the young kids aren't getting into farming, so they're converting it back to trees. We put 349 acres of pasture or fields back in trees last year. Not that many this year. We don't have but two tracts. Urban forestry, if you've got a tree on your property, we can come help you. Whether it's a yard tree, shade tree, fruit tree, whatever. Everybody pays taxes, tax money funds us, so we help any and everybody from 1 acre or one tree to 1,000 acres, don't matter. And we're an unbiased opinion. We have no dog to hunt, so we're looking after your interest in what you want to do. School programs. Alamance County hosts a state Envirothon competition and has since 1992. We've been involved in that. We help the high schools and middle schools in the counties prepare their teams. We also write the test and teach the kids at that event, and it's usually 800 to 1,200 kids come here to Alamance County for this competition. We also help Boy Scouts, Cub Scouts, all of the organizations in the county with the kids, either with Smokey Bear or forestry information. We do login inspections, and if you look on page 6, that's actually one of the good ones. This logger put in bridge mats to cross the creek instead of pushing a road in and making a ford. When he gets finished, all of this is pulled out. The creek banks are still intact. He seeds and mulch, cuts down the erosion and the sediment getting in the creek. We check 54 logging inspections were conducted while the operation was active. We found 7 violations that were corrected. We've conducted 46 inspections this year since July 1st, and 19 of them were active. 958 acres of woodlands were impacted. The last item there is the forestry present use. Probably about half of our involvement with forest management plans are present use tracts or new tracts coming in. The rest of them are already in the program where the taxes are deferred for forestry just like they are for ag. And forestry is one of the lowest uses you can get, excuse me, besides wasteland. But it's still making the landowner and the county money. Any questions?
All the downed trees due to the ice storm, isn't that going to increase fire?
Yes.
You know, the risk of more serious fire?
It will greatly impact it, and it will impact our available or our control time, because it's going to make it more difficult for our equipment and our manpower to put containment lines around these fires. The good thing about it, most of the tracks that we're seeing so far were just bent over where the tops were broken out. The trees, as long as they're not over 45 degree lean to them, they will stand back up. And as long as you've got 4 or 5 good green limbs on the trees will recover from the broken top. It'll just be a defect in the log, but it will not kill the tree.
Were the trees just, I know we had a lot of ice, but were they just real brittle due to the previous rainfall of the previous summer, or what do you think?
The rainfall doesn't affect the brittleness of the trees. It will affect the holding capacity of the roots.
Well,
so the ones you saw blown over,
right,
that was the cause of that. It's the nature of pine and poplar that they're naturally brittle. So most of the time you're going to see that as the biggest impact in the woodland setting. Okay. Yeah. Because of those trees, they can't handle the ice. With the pines, the shorter needle pines, Virginia pine and shortleaf, you won't see them as impacted as much as you will loblolly, because Virginia pine and shortleaf are our native pines for this area. Lob, we're bringing in, so you'll get a greater impact on those because they're more Piedmont, you know, coastal plane tree.
Anything else?
Mr. Chairman, one reason we wanted Ranger Walbert to be here is there is a budget allocation that the county does. And currently our budget allocation for this year, which was approved, is about $70,000. And he is asking for an increase a little over $81,000 for the next budget year. So, you know, he wanted to come and present and show the value of what the Forestry Service does as we begin our budget process.
Right, and I forgot, I didn't highlight it in here. We are requesting money for a new Type 6 engine. Our oldest truck is an 2006, and it's about 100,000 miles on it now, and these are initial attack engines that attack these wildfires. And we're looking to get some more money to replace that Type 6 engine. Both of the vehicles we drive are Type 6 initial attack engines.
Anything else? Thank you, Ranger Walker.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Manager, what is the public hearing approval?
Does Bruce want to do that, or
That's the county line, Mr. Chairman.
County line. Requesting a public hearing for the resolution on the county line with Guilford County. Is that correct, Clyde?
That's correct. We have come to another stage in this long process. The letters have gone out, and Friday was the deadline. Bruce can tell you about how many properties we're thinking about making a change based on our criteria.
As of Friday, 60 out of 74 that qualified to petition have sent the petition in to stay in Alamance County. At this point, the next process is the public hearing, and we will be meeting with Guilford County to go over that.
Guilford's going to also schedule a public hearing to review their petition as well. And the next step is to get the surveys in. We'll bring those back to the board at the public hearing to get more detailed information on how many people have decided to stay in Alamance County.
We'll have a map and everything for you because they have to have it postmarked by Friday, so there's still some trickling in. So for the public hearing, we'll have all that information for you.
So what we're asking for is to set the public hearing for the 21st of April.
Any questions?
Well, we have maps as to how much you're going to zigzag the line with approval.
Yes, sir.
Are there any cul-de-sacs involved?
Cul-de-sacs?
Don't tell me there's one on that side, too.
There's one that goes north-south in McIntosh and the Lake. There's another one in Beaver Hills.
But you're actually taking the county line around a cul-de-sac on the Guilford side? Is that what you're saying?
No, those people are staying. Those people qualified who are currently taxpayers to stay in, so that cul-de-sac would stay in.
But just for the sake of this, we took the Alamance Orange county line, zigzag, and I opposed it. But we took it around a cul-de-sac, and it's the biggest joke I've ever seen in my life. Are we taking the county line on the Alamance Guilford side around any cul-de-sacs?
It's hard to understand what you're asking for. I mean,
well, the line, the GDA line is going to be straight. It ain't going to be around any cul-de-sacs. It'd go straight. It would have been straight on Alamance Orange, but you took it around a cul-de-sac, a circle. A county line is not a circle. And a real county line, honored by geodetic surveys.
I know which one you're talking about. Okay. I don't think it's, no, it doesn't follow that particular way. Again, it just keeps people.
I understand that, but are there any circles? Are there any cul-de-sacs?
Not like the one we had in Orange.
Anything close to that one?
I guess it's in the eye of the beholder. I mean.
Oh, my goodness. Okay, I'm sorry.
I mean, we're going to have the maps for you. I'm going to have them downstairs.
I think what he's saying is anywhere on that line, is it curved?
It is not curved, no.
No curves on
that. No curves.
Line.
It's just jagged. Falling property, falling
cul-de-sacs are curved.
Yeah. All right. Okay. Anything else on this?
What do you do with a piece of property that's half in, or half is a probably a statement I should make, partially in both counties? What determines what, you know, which county it goes into?
Well, the rules were based, and they adopted the exact same rules for Orange County that we did with Orange County. So if it was a certain size or smaller, usually in a subdivision, they put the whole property in. If it's a very large track, it goes up to 150 feet. Again, the whole purpose is to keep that home in Alamance County.
So the home determines not the barn, not the acreage.
Not the barn, no.
Primary residence.
Yeah, the spirit of it, and Bill's been involved, and everybody was, again, we asked the state to tell us where the line was. People that are going to be moved from one county to the other have the one-time opportunity to petition to stay. And it's really focused on their homes and families and voting, people that have been in the county this whole time. So that was the compromise that came from that whole process that we had done. We did fulfill that in 2012, and then Orange County said they wanted to follow the same procedure, so we've been doing that.
Guilford, excuse me.
We'll receive a copy of the rules and the maps before this public hearing, is that correct?
Yeah, I think we've already sent out the rules.
We should have the criteria, we can get those too.
All right, thank you.
Absolutely.
I've probably received as many or more calls about this issue than any one other issue that I can imagine. It's been a lot.
It's contentious.
Bruce and I have been living this dream for 7 years now, I think.
Well, y'all opened Pandora's box when we started. Now, I'm going to say this. First of all, I want to update on North Carolina, South Carolina,
okay,
where the two states have the same issue, and they're drawing the geodetic line as the state line, is my understanding.
Yes, sir.
And they're telling people that think they're in one state, we're sorry, but you're going to be in the other state. You got to get their driver's license, but we're going to grandfather in some stuff. Am I not correct there?
Well, in the North Carolina, South Carolina, last time I checked, it was about a month and a half after we talked about it, was they had, you know, of course, South Carolina had put permanent monumentation on the ground, which made it easier to do that. They still hadn't made a final determination on the gentleman who was selling fireworks.
Right, the store on the line.
And the
right.
Gas station. So, right. You know, in South Carolina you can sell them, North Carolina you can't. So that was one of the issues, and they didn't know how they were going to do it. They had a complete change on their board.
Mm-hmm.
So I haven't heard
I bet you a dollar they don't draw the line behind his store and then come back out like they did at Mill Creek. And just for the sake of your education on this, I would, and you may know already, but I would recommend that you check with Wake County, where they had the debate with Franklin, the county of the state capital. In my opinion, that couldn't be a bigger precedent. And you had a developer that wanted the line moved around to satisfy his development, and both sets of county commissioners voted to use geodetic, and that was it. And that if the line ran through your house, the principle that I've heard for 50 years of my life, basically, of the 64, when I was 14, I couldn't care less, that wherever your master bedroom was is the taxes that you pay for that house, wherever your master bedroom is. And that if you had a piece of property split, Guilford does this now with Randolph, that if you have a piece of property split, you pay the portion of taxes where that land is, and you pay the other portion for where the other. They don't combine everything. And we open Pandora's box with this. If y'all vote any way you want, but I'll never support moving the county line, zigzagging it. And for God's sake, putting around a cul-sac's biggest joke I ever heard in surveys.
Well, it's a two-edged sword, obviously, as we all know. That is, residents that have been in Alamance County don't want to go to Guilford. And that's a good thing, that they want to stay in our county. But as an attorney, I have not completed title searches and so forth in years. One of the best days of my practice when I quit doing closings and title searches. But, Mr. Albright and I both would probably agree, attorneys would like to have a straight line, because then you can determine where properties are without going to this map and a lot of confusion. Property owners don't necessarily want that, so it's going to be a tough debate.
One of the things
what is the public hearing to decide? We've already voted one time on the line, isn't that correct?
To approve the petitions that have been filed.
For those who have a choice.
For those that have a choice.
The public hearing is to approve that. Yes. The line has been decided. We're just this public hearing for these, how many, 60 some?
Yeah, it's about 75.
Okay. All right, that's what the issue is. It's not whether we're going, how we're going to do the line. That's been voted on.
I don't believe we've voted on the Guilford Alamance line.
We did.
Yes, we did.
The only thing I remember was a 3-2 vote to allow the procedure to continue. And y'all went over there with a non-quorum and met with a full quorum of their board, which I still protest. And we have not voted on the actual line. We voted on a process of continuing the Mickey Mouse procedures that you went on with.
That's correct. And so
that's what I thought.
The people have received the petitions. We are getting back what they desire to be. Again, those are our taxpayers. And the next step of the process is, again, you're going to have the materials to see exactly who voted what and see which of the maps. And then, you know, we've given examples of the letters for those people. So then you decide if you want to accept that and continue the process, which would be surveying around those properties, going to both registered deeds, because there's a big procedure that makes sure that when they do a title search, it's not an issue.
Mr. Albright, could we receive, because I was not on the board at that time, obviously, I would love to have the minutes from that, particularly that segment of the meeting where this was discussed or approved or whatever. I want to know what the motion was, what was approved, and what the vote was.
The General Assembly, based on that, approved a statute that set forth this procedure for Guilford and Alamance.
Now, I'm at the vote here.
We get to the minutes.
Thank you.
So the final vote on the line will be after we approve or disapprove these people's request to stay in Alamance County?
One of the things that was part of the procedure was, again, people have a right to vote to say, I would like to please stay in Alamance County, and I'm willing to pay for it. So this part of the process is, if you approve it, then they're going to go out and hire their surveyors to do the deviation. And so we did, you know, part of the legal process, you don't want to make people do surveys and then take it away from them at that point. You know, if you approve it, then they're moving forward.
And then maps are created, and the geodetic survey folks in Raleigh approve those maps, and then it's produced and provided to the General Assembly for their final approval, and then the line will be filed.
General Assembly has final approval for the line.
Yes, sir.
Not the county.
Yes,
I hear there's some backlash down in Raleigh over this issue, or not necessarily this particular issue, but issue of similarity of moving lines like this. Have you heard of anything?
I haven't.
I don't know who told me that. Somebody told me that last week. But last comment, the Guilford County Board of Commissioners unanimously voted to take geodetic. And we didn't act at that moment, which we should have, in my opinion, to go ahead and solve it and go with geodetic. We just sat back and just let Pandora's box just get even wider. Now, after their election, they had commissioners put on their board, some of them, it's my understanding, that didn't even realize that you're not supposed to, that you don't move county lines, which by historical precedent were geographical and political boundaries. That you don't move county lines. They didn't know that you didn't move county lines like you do municipal lines or school board lines and so forth and so on. So it's probably been, in my opinion, the worst academic debate I have ever seen in my life of practicality of how to run county government. And that's why I have voted no the whole time about moving county lines, and except for geodetic, which is as professional as you can get, and I'll never support moving county lines past beyond geodetic. And I'm just stunned still that we're still almost endorsing that process.
So we have a motion to set the public hearing for April
21.
Second. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you, Bruce. The next, Chuck Mansell is here.
I support a public hearing. Don't mean I'm going to support what it said.
The EMS video. Chuck, here.
I haven't seen it.
We wanted to kind of show you a video that was done by the North Carolina National Guard, which focuses on one of our employees in EMS. So is Chuck.
You've seen me on the TV cleaning up the speech. Today I'm in the classroom. It's my turn to teach. Tomorrow night I may be headed somewhere cold and far. Let me introduce myself, I am your National Guard.
I have served this great state as a civilian teacher for 15 years. I am your National Guard.
I'm your first militia, man, don't tread on me. I've been there beside you, seen shining sea. I've fought every battle, Lexington and Kandahar. In case you haven't met me, I am your National Guard.
I'm Captain Mike
Lord Jesus. I've served this great state as a civilian firefighter for 25 years.
Fight fires, hurricanes, and floods across our land. I'm no stranger to Iraq or Afghanistan. I'm a stay-at-home mom, a city cop, my world belongs to y'all. And I'll be there, I'm everywhere, I am your National Guard.
I am your National Guard. I'm private first class Adam Barker, and I live in Elon, North Carolina, and I am a National Guard soldier.
I am your National Guard.
I have served this great state as a civilian fleet maintenance superintendent for 5 years, and I am your National Guard.
I am Sergeant Randy Powell. I've served this great state as the rangemaster for the CMPD for 24 years.
Yeah, I fight fires, hurricanes, and floods across our land. And I'm no stranger to Iraq or Afghanistan.
Serving the National Guard as a C-130 instructor pilot, and I've been serving this great state mission for 21 years. I'll be there. I'm everywhere. I am the National Guard.
I'll be there. I'm everywhere. I am your National Guard.
Your National Guard.
I am Jim Yatchin. I have served this great state as a civilian police officer for 24 years. And I am a North Carolina National Guard soldier.
And again, we're apologize, I couldn't be here, but wanted to recognize him, and they had film crew here for a couple of days, and we appreciate the work that he does, not only for Alamance County, but for also our state as well, and appreciate Chuck's support of him in his service to the state and country.
Budget amendment, Susan.
Yes, sir. As you know, we occasionally get additional funds throughout the year. So this is just finalizing some of the things that we've gotten since the last budget amendment. We got some more crisis intervention. That's our energy money. We also got some admin to go with that. We lost some SSBG, but we got some additional permanency plan and money to offset it. So all of this offsets except for adult daycare, which has a $679 county match that we'll take out of our current budget. So that's the impact on our budget.
Any questions? Any comments? Have a motion?
So moved.
Second? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Bye. Budget amendment.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I come before you today with a request for additional funds to defend the sheriff against the Department of Justice. And let me start by saying that something Mr. Hsu referred to earlier in our meeting, the Department of Justice is supposed to pay for our legal experts when they take their deposition. They refused to pay. We had to file a motion and a brief and calendar that. And then right before the calendaring of the motion and the hearing of the motion, they said, oh, we're going to pay it. I cite that as an example of the operating motive and methods of these folks. It's like no other case I've ever been involved in. We have received their brief Friday evening at about 6:15. Our response is going to be filed today. We've worked on it diligently. We have it ready. It will be filed today. But we have about five other briefs that we're going to have to prepare and file. a brief in motion of support of our motion to strike their expert Lambert, a brief in support of our motion to strike their expert Frazier's report, and a brief in support of our motion to strike their expert McDonald's report, plus our witness preparation list and our pretrial brief. All of these have to be done. There are over 800 pages of exhibits,
that we've had to go through. We've had over 60 depositions. It is a mountain of a case, and that's why we've spent so much money defending it. They're trying to make this as expensive as possible for the sheriff. We do believe that this last request will get us to summary judgment.
When is it supposed to be heard?
It's supposed to be heard within the next few weeks. We're going to have it filed and calendared, ready to go. It depends on the court when they want to hear it. They want to hear it.
Deed has not been set.
Hasn't been set, not yet.
Any questions?
I'd appreciate just letting me know when the hearing's going to be held.
Of course.
I don't know that I can attend, but I sure would like to be there.
You're welcome to attend. They're open to the public. We've been in Winston-Salem Federal Court.
Do we have a motion?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye. Thank you.
Thank you, Clyde. Tom, Finance Officer?
I defer to our budget meeting, Mr. Chairman.
County Manager?
Nothing really to update at this time.
Commissioners, any comments? Commissioners, anything you want to say?
I don't say that almost.
All right, the Budget Committee is meeting after this meeting is concluded. Tom, I think you would like to invite all the commissioners to
yes,
be
sir.
Present. If you would, Tom's going to make a report on projected revenues and the total requests for in their budgets. There appearing to be nothing else, do I hear a motion to adjourn this meeting?
So moved.
All in favor?
Aye.
We'll take a short break.
Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur at 7 p.m. on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the County Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 o'clock p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of commissioner meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says Alamance County Commissioners to visit the commissioners' website, where you can learn about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.